Okay. So, I have started the recording. So let me start continuing our discussion. So Professor Shural, I guess that I am audible and the slides are visible, right?
Yeah, everything is in order.
Okay. So in the last class, we were talking about this concept of snore multi-signature for this collective signing method. So what we have seen that is snore multi-signature, it works on a group G of prime order. So on a group G of prime order, the discrete logarithmic problem is hard. So typically, in this discrete logarithmic problem, it is not very difficult, the general case, when you need to find out the value of x such that y to the power x equal to z. Given y and z, you need to find out the value of x. So typically that is okay, but on a group of prime order, such kind of discrete logarithmic problem is hard. So it uses that philosophy, and based on that, it generates the private public key pair. And if you remember that in case of snore multi-signature, the advantage is that when individual nodes or individual validators are signing a message with their private key and we are finding out the aggregated signature, then at the same time, we can generate an aggregated public key, which is basically the product of the public key for all the signers. So you can generate this aggregated public key, and this aggregated public key can be directly used to verify the message. So that is the kind of advantage which I have. Now, based on this snore multi-signature, the collective signing protocol works in four different phases. So in the first phase, the way this COSAI protocol works is that the leader and the witnesses that we have, they are arranged in the form of a tree. So the tree structure sorry, I guess that my connection got interrupted in between. So am I audible now?
Yeah, you are audible now. You had dropped off in between for a few seconds.
Right. So I was discussing about this implementation of the collective signing protocol based on the snore multi-signature. So in case of the collective signing protocol, the nodes are arranged in the form of a tree. So the advantage of using a tree for the collecting signature is that we can use the logarithmic nature, logarithmic complexity nature of a tree. So in logarithmic time, you can propagate the message and you can get back the signatures and generate the collective response. So this COSAI protocol works in four stages. So in the first stage, that is called the announcement stage. So if you just look into the basic architecture of the snore multi-signature, so in case of snore multi-signature, to generate the signature, what you have to do that every signer, they picks up some random secret. Well, and after they have that random secret, aggregate that by computing the product and uses a hash function to create a challenge. Then this procedure is relatively for so announcement phase is basically saying broadcast message that we are going to sign collectively something, so send us that random signal. So in the commitment phase, that is the phase two of the COSAI protocol, this first phase of the signing work. So in the commitment phase, every signer picks up this random secret VI and generate this capsub here. Well, and the leader finally computes the collective fee as a product of VI. So this phase is simulated in this way that every node they generate this value of V. So three generate V, three, four generates V, four, and so on. And as it gets propagated upward to the tree at every phase, that aggregation is being done. So for example, when V1 gets the value of V3 and V4, V1 finds out the aggregated value as V1, V3, V4. Well, then when in the same way, V2 finds out that aggregated value as V2, V5, V6. So these values are again sent back to the leader. So V0 is the leader here. So the leader then find out the aggregated values as what it has received from V1 multiplied by what it has received from V2. Well, so that way the aggregation is being done. So after this aggregation is being done, then the third phase of the signing works. So in the third phase of the signing, the leader finds something that is the product of all the individual challenges for the signers. And then it uses the hash function to compute the collective challenge. Well, so this is basically done in the third phase. So in the third phase, the leader prepared this challenge and sent that challenge to all the witnesses, okay, across the tree. Now, once every witness receives this challenge, they basically finds out the final signature. Well, so the final signature is computed by Ri equal to Vi minus C of Xi. So they basically use this formula to compute the final Ri. And at every stage, this aggregation is being done. Okay, so the aggregation is R equal to sum of Ri. So this aggregation is done at every stage. So that means three computes R3, four computes R4. So R3 and R4 are sent to R1. Then R1 compute its own R1, its own sign, and then aggregate it. Okay, so the aggregated value becomes, say, R1 cap equal to R1 plus R3 plus R4. Similarly, R5 plus R6. So these things are propagated to the leader, and then leader finds out the aggregated value by R1 cap plus R2 cap, plus its own R0. So that way, using these four phases of COSAI, as we mentioned earlier, that two COSAI rounds actually prepare commit. So this one round of so certain network issues are happening today, not very sure because of this heavy rain that is possibly happening here in Kharagpur. So as I was mentioning that these two COSAI rounds, they implement PPFT's three rounds. So the first COSAI round implement PPFT's pre-prepare and the prepare phases. So if you remember the pre-prepare and the prepare phases of PPFT, they are basically used to have certain kind of commitment from the participants that they are participating in PPFT. So here the initial announcement followed by this commitment that actually emulates the pre-prepare phase for COSAI. And then this challenge response, they implement the prepare phase of COSAI. And then another COSAI round starting from announcement to response, that emulates the PPFT's commit phase. So that way, this three round of PBFT that can be simulated using two round of the COSAI protocol. Well, now, by utilizing this COSAI protocol, we are going to design a blockchain consensus mechanism. So for that, let us quickly revisit the requirements for the blockchain consensus. So the requirements that we had was, first one is Byzantine fault tolerance. That means I need to ensure that the system should work even in the presence of Byzantine users. Then it should provide strong consistency guarantee across replicas. The third one is that it should scale well to increasing workload. And the fourth one is that it should scale well to increasing network size. Well, now let us see that how we can utilize COSAI to support this requirement of blockchain consensus. So earlier we discussed about this Bitcoin NG. So the issue that was there with Bitcoin NG is that if a key block is faulty, then that key block will be able to add a number of micro blocks. Well, so that way a faulty miner can introduce a number of correct micro blocks following a faulty micro block in the system. Well, so it is a kind of overhead for the application. Well, and whenever you have a fork, that problem becomes further challenging to find out all these faulty key block and the micro block, then remove all the subsequent micro blocks. So for example, if one of the micro block becomes faulty, we need to assume that the miner is malicious and I need to remove actually all the micro blocks, including the key block. So that way the overhead is high. So this problem is basically solved in Bitcoin by a set of PBFT verifiers. Well, so who will verify a block, and then only the block is added in the blockchain. So the idea is that because I am relying on a single miner to add multiple blocks, and in that way, if the miner is faulty and the miner intelligently pushes a faulty micro block in the system, then it would be difficult to detect. And once it is detected, then all the key blocks and micro blocks need to be removed. To simplify this process, we use this concept of PBFT verifiers. That means I want to have a set of witness, or I want to have a set of verifier who will verify a block before it is added to my blockchain. Well, and for this verification purpose, we use this concept of COSAI. Now a question might immediately come that why can't we use the PBFT based verification? So I can use PBFT, and using PBFT I can verify a block, and then that block can be added. But the problem with PBFT is that PBFT requires a static consensus group that we have seen earlier, because PBFT is entirely works on the message passing idea. Well, further, the scalability is a problem for PBFT, because PBFT works only with a handful number of nodes. So the communication complexity for PBFT is O of n square, and the verification complexity for PBFT is O of n. Well, and that way with PBFT, one of the major problem is that you can have civil attack. Well, so basically an attacker may create multiple pseudonyms or multiple identities to subvert that 3A+1 requirement. Well, and remember that whenever we are talking about consensus here, we are actually talking about in an open environment. That means my consensus environment is still open. And when my consensus environment is open, and in an open environment I want to apply PBFT, then that becomes a challenge. Well, so that's why we cannot directly use PBFT to do this signature procedure. But what we can do, that we can open up the consensus group by utilizing COSAI. Well, so what I can do, that I can use a proof of work based system to give a proof of membership of a miner as a part of the trustees. So to sign a block collectively by a set of witness, what I need a set of nodes who are going to work like a witness. Well, now the question comes that how I am going to select that set of group, set of nodes who are going to work as the witness. So for that purpose, we use proof of work. Well, so what proof of work does? Proof of work basically helps me to identify a set of nodes who are going to work like the witness. So earlier, when we applied proof of work in the context of Bitcoin mining, what we have seen, that proof of work basically returns a leader. Well, and that leader is now going to propose a new block. Now here what we are doing, we are using proof of work to select multiple such nodes. rather a kind of consensus group rather than a single leader. Well, so that way, if I try to use it in rounds, what we can ensure, we can maintain a balance of power within this BFT consensus group. So what we can do, we can use a fixed size window, and each time a miner finds a new block, it receives a consensus group share, and this share proves the miner's membership as a part of the witness group. Well, so this way this entire Bitcoin idea works. So that means, say the key blocks that I have, so these different colored blocks that are shown here, they are the kind of key blocks. So what we do, that the recent miners who have mined the block, they become a part of my witness. Well, so I basically find out that how many such key blocks have been mined by a miner. Say for this YOLO miner, it has mined two groups, so it has 2/3 of the share. The red miner, it has mined two groups, so it has 2/3 of the share. The blue miner, it has mined three blocks, so it has, say, 1/3 of the share, okay? So that way I find out the shares for every individual miners. And once I find out the share for every individual miners, I pick up the top end miners and they become my consensus group. Well, and they will collectively run the COSI protocol to sign a message. So whenever I am going to this kind of architecture, obviously I can improve the communication complexity as well as verification complexity, because now I am just selecting the last few miners, or rather the miners who have been mined certain number of blocks in a blockchain, and I am using those miners to create this consensus group. Well, so let us see that how this entire thing works. So in case of Bitcoin, then what actually happens, that I have formed up this way the consensus group by picking up the miners who have generated the key block. Now every block that is being generated by a miner, that block will be signed by these witnesses. Well, so that means every block, before adding it to the blockchain, I am passing the block through a PBFT consensus mechanism, and the miners who are part of that witness group for that PBFT consensus, and this PBFT consensus is simulated using the COSI protocol, the collective signing protocol. So these nodes, they collectively putting the signature on the block, saying that this block is valid, and then this block is added to the blockchain. Well, so this is the kind of broad idea behind Bitcoin. So now if you just try to see the Bitcoin performance, so what we can see, that compared to Bitcoin, this lower line is the Bitcoin. Compared to Bitcoin, Bitcoin significantly improved transactions per second. Well, depending on how you are making a combination of COSI and the number of miners. So here actually we consider two different cases. The result they have shown, one is the COSI implemented on a flat architecture, and the COSI implemented on a tree architecture. So a COSI implemented on a tree architecture, it can significantly improve the consensus. So at least if you look into the average transactions for people, which is around 500 transactions per second, so we can with a block size of 32 or block size of 16 MB, Bitcoin can reach into that limit. Well, so that way, compared to Bitcoin, Bitcoin significantly improves the performance of consensus. So this is the kind of core idea of Bitcoin, that where we are in an interesting way, we have combined proof of work with PBFT. So the proof of work is helping me to find out a member of a witness group or a consensus group, what we are calling it. And then the members of the consensus group, they collectively sign every block using the COSI protocol. Well, so that is the kind of broad idea behind Bitcoin. Well, so let me know if you have any doubt on Bitcoin. Okay. So next, let me proceed in discussing one of the very interesting consensus algorithms. Actually, some people claim that this particular consensus algorithm actually revolutionized the blockchain architecture, although very recently there are a lot of criticism on this architecture as well. So it is called Algorand. So this Algorand that was published in 2017, the idea initially came around late 2016, proposed by a group from MIT, led by Silvio Micali from MIT Media Lab. So they proposed an algorithm by intelligently combining Byzantine agreement protocols with cryptographic techniques. And the algorithm that they proposed, they say that it can scale up the Byzantine agreement protocol for cryptocurrencies. So what we have seen earlier, that typically the Byzantine agreement protocols works good when you have less than 20 nodes in your consensus group. But if you have large number of participants in your consensus procedure, then this Byzantine agreement doesn't work. So what they have proposed, or the idea that they have proposed, that particular idea actually helps to have multiple nodes, or rather a large number of nodes, to participate in a Byzantine agreement protocol. That gives certain interesting idea about how you can scale up this Byzantine agreement protocol for millions of nodes that can possibly support cryptocurrencies. So Algorand is very popular nowadays in the blockchain community. Multiple different applications, we are relying on Algorand, but as I have mentioned, there are also many criticism on Algorand as well. While discussing that, I am going to point out some of those criticism that people are doing on the architecture of Algorand. Again, what I would say that if you remember that in one of the classes, I have shown you a cartoon where there is something written on the floor. So if you look it from one side, it looks 6, and from other side, it looks 9. So the same kind of things keep on happening. Also in Algorand, the same kind of dilemma is there. So they basically make certain assumptions in their protocol, which help them to scale up the system. But at the same time, they combine certain interesting ideas, and those ideas help them to claim that this particular mechanism, a particular open consensus mechanism, is going to scale up or going to give throughput equivalent to the BFT consensus algorithms, whereas in terms of node scalability, it supports something similar to proof of work. Well, so that means it is somehow balancing between or taking the best from proof of work as well as the BFT consensus. So let us try to see it. So if I just try to look into the basic idea of Bitcoin, so the key idea of Bitcoin was to achieve consensus through proof of work. The communication technique that was used in Bitcoin was the gossip protocol, as we seen earlier. And the key assumption there was that the honest majority of the mining computation power. Well, so that means that mining computation power, at least more than 50% of the miners, they should be honest. Well, so that was the kind of requirement which we had. Now, the limitations, if we have look, the limitations of Bitcoin. So the first limitation that we seen earlier also, that the resource wastage. So it need high computational as well as electricity cost. Then the kind of concentration of power, that means typically if you just try to look into, you see that only 5 mining pools, they control the entire system. Around 5 mining pools, they control the entire system. It is vulnerable because it is easy to track the miners. As I mentioned, that if you just look into this particular link, which shows the recent blocks blockchain, Bitcoin blockchain. So let me open it and try to show it to you. Just share my screen. Okay. So here, if you just try to see the miner or the mining pool who have generated the recent blocks, you see that it is F2 pool, then AND pool, then via BTC, then again AND pool, then F2 pool, then again via BTC, F2 pool, and pull, F to pull, F to pull, F to pull, and pull, F to pull, and pull, and pull. So you see that maximum blocks have been generated by two mining spool, F to pull, and pull. Okay. So here I see a different name, pull in. Well, otherwise either it is unknown, that means people have not been able to track that who has generated it. Possibly it is some individual miner, not a mining pool, but otherwise it is some mining pool, and majority of those are either ant pool or F to pool. Well, so the latest few blocks that I can see in the first page, majority of those blocks have been generated by either ant pool or F to pool. Well, so here you can see a kind of clear monopoly. Okay, monopoly in the sense that you can see that two mining pools, they are controlling most of the blocks, and that is something problematic for Bitcoin architecture or the proof of work architecture, as we discussed earlier. So this kind of problem keeps on happening on the entire system, and because of that reason, it is said that proof of work mechanism is kind of vulnerable. Well, so the question comes that how I can solve this particular problem. Well, so let me go back to the slides. Okay. Fine. So that is the kind of problems. Then the scalability is obviously a problem that we had seen earlier, particularly the high latency. And finally, the ambiguity. So we could not reach consensus finality because there is a possibility of having a fork in blockchain. Now, in contrast to that, if you try to look into this blockchain performance triangle, so it is always difficult to support scalability, security, and decentralization together. Well, and we need to make a balance between scalability, security, and decentralization. So the question comes, that how can we have a balance between these three requirements of blockchain consensus? Well, so in that context, if I just try to give you an overview of Algorand, so the key idea behind Algorand is that they use consensus through Byzantine Agreement Protocol, because you remember that Byzantine Agreement, one of the major advantages of Byzantine Agreement Protocols are that although it works for small number of nodes, but it supports millions of transactions per second. So the transaction throughput is very, very high for Byzantine Agreement Protocol. Well, the only limitation is that it works on within a small group. So the question comes that how can we make it work within a small group? Well, or how can I make it work when I have large number of nodes? The communication protocol is used as the gossip, the same one that we used for Bitcoin. And the key assumption here is the honest majority of money. Okay, so honest majority of the money means the participants who got majority of the algorithms or majority of the coins, they basically share the consensus algorithms among themselves. Well, so that means if I have 10% of the entire money, so I would be able to participate in 10% of the consensus procedure. So that way, it is distributed in the network in the form of this sharing of money. Means some idea which is similar to proof of stake that we discussed earlier. So the technical advancement that is made by algorithms are as follows. So first is that the trivial computation. So it uses simple operations like add, count, something like that. It works on with a true decentralization. So they do not have any kind of concentration of mining pool power. Every miners are treated equally. The finality of the payment. So fork might happen in Algorand, but they show that the possibility of fork in Algorand is very, very low. So if a block is generated for majority of the cases, it is not only the majority of the cases. So basically the probability of fork in Algorand is 0.00001. So that means possibly in 0.001% of cases, you can have a fork. So that way, majority of the blocks are the final blocks. it is scalable in terms of users as well as the transaction throughput. So in terms of latency, it works with the network latency, and it provides security. Okay, so security against a bad adversary. So let us see that what are the ideas that have been included in Algorand. So if you just try to look into the basic architecture of Algorand, the basic architecture of Algorand is pretty simple. So the algorithm is something like that. So you select a random user. That random user will prepare a block. Well, and you propagate that block in the network through gossiping. Well, so that means the random user, any random user in your network, that will propose a block, and that block will propagate in the network with gossiping. Now comes the interesting part. The interesting part is that the block that is being generated, I need to verify that block with the help of a set of PBFT verifiers. Well, so what we have seen earlier, that Byzantine Agreement Protocols, they are scalable in terms of transaction throughput. They can support millions of transactions, but their problem is that they do not scale well with increasing number of nodes. So that means I need to select a small committee who will sign that block, which is being proposed by a random user. Well, so what happens here, that we select a random committee with small number of users. So they say that, well, in contrast to number of participants who are there in the Algorand network, you can select around 10K users. That is still very small because you have millions of users. And then you run Byzantine agreement on that block. If an agreement is reached, then you digitally sign the result and propagate the digital signature mentioning that this block is committed in the blockchain. Well, so the core idea is something like that, because the Byzantine agreement protocol doesn't scale well with millions of users in a large network. So what you do, that you create a small committee out of those users, and that committee will run the Byzantine agreement protocol to come to an agreement on a proposed block. And if an agreement is reached, then that block will be signed. Now here comes the question, that who will select this committee? Okay, because I have, say, millions of users, and out of those millions of users, I need to select some nodes who will be part of the committee. So to select the committee, here comes the interesting aspect of Algorand. It uses a mechanism which is called cryptographic shortation. What is a cryptographic shortation? A cryptographic shortation is basically where every member will select itself as a part of the committee. Okay? So what will happen, that I will run this cryptographic shortation algorithm. So this cryptographic shortation algorithm that is being executed by every member or every participant independently, and they generate something. What they are going to generate, we are going to discuss it in the next slide. So they generate something which works like a proof that they have been elected to be a part of the committee based on this cryptographic shortation mechanism. Well, and if they are getting elected to be a part of the committee, they propagate a message saying that, hey, I have been elected. Well, and these messages get propagated in the network, and everyone finds out, well, out of this, all the nodes who are there, these three nodes have been selected by the cryptographic shortation mechanism. Who is going to be the part of the committee for the next round? Well, now let us see that how this cryptographic shortation works. So as I mentioned, that in cryptographic shortation, each committee member, it will select himself or herself according to some per user weight. So this weight comes from the amount of money that I have. Well, so this shortation mechanism, where everyone elect itself or decides whether it is getting elected, so this shortation mechanism is implemented using something called a verifiable random function. So I'm not going to the cryptographic details of a verifiable random function. If you are interested in learning about verifiable random function, you can look into it. So what a verifiable random function does? So a verifiable random function, it takes a public-private key pair and an input string. x. Okay, so this verifiable random function is a function of x and a public key, and it generates a hash and a proof. Well, so what is this hash? So this hash is an unique value that is being determined from sk and x. And along with that hash, I am generating a proof. This proof will verify or help in verifying that this hash has been generated from this x. Well, so that verification will be done using this proof. So a verifiable random function, it takes input the public key and the input string and accordingly generate this hash and the proof, saying that see, this hash has been generated. And corresponds to this hash, I have a proof that will tell me, or that will help anyone to verify whether the hash has been generated from the correct verifiable random function or not. Well, now this verifiable random function is used to implement cryptographic sortition in Algorand. So how it works? So every node, they run this sortition function. So what this sortition function does, this sortition function takes a set of parameters. One is obviously the public key, SK is the public key. Then the seed, so the seed is a publicly known random value. Well, so the seed is basically determined by some random generator. This is published for every round R. And to generate the seed, we also use this verifiable random function. So one of the important property of this verifiable random function is that if your input remains same, that means if you do not change the input, then your output doesn't get changed. Well, so the output is always corresponding to a specific input. Well, so that way, if every node gives the same input, then they will generate the same output. Well, so that way, the seed value is also generated from a verifiable random function. The seed value that have been used in round R minus one, that from that seed, by applying a verifiable random function, the seed for round R is generated. Now, apart from the seed, you take a threshold value. So this threshold value basically determines the expected number of users that should be selected. Well, so if it is a committee, so here you see that I need to use this verifiable random function for two different purposes. One is for selecting this random user who is going to propagate the block, then to select the members of a random committee who is going to run the Byzantine Agreement Protocol. Well, so depending on whether I need one member, that means a random user who is going to propose the block, or I need n number of members who is going to be a part of the committee, I put up this threshold. Well, then there is a role parameter, that is whether I am going to select a node for proposing a block or going to select someone as a committee member, then the weight of a user and the weight of all the users. Well, and finally, a value j. So this j basically indicates that whether a user has been elected to get participated in the procedure or not. Well, if j is less than threshold, that means the user has been elected to participate in the procedure. Well, so for example, whenever I want to select a single random user using the verifiable random function, I basically tell that this value of threshold is one. So that means if j is one, then that participant is selected as the random user who is going to propagate the block. If j is equal to zero, that means that participant is not getting selected. So if I want to have 10 members committee, then threshold is 10. Now, if the value of j is in between 1 and 10, that means that participant has been elected to be a part of the committee. If it is 0, that means it has not been elected. So that way we use this verifiable random function to generate that whether I am getting elected as a part of the committee or I am getting elected as the random user who is going to propagate this block. And then this information is gossiped to other members in the Algorand network. Well, so everyone can get the value, and when everyone is getting that value, they can use this proof to verify whether the computation is correct or not. well, whether they have given the correct input. So this input is known to everyone. Well, so they can use this input to verify whether this hash has been generated by providing the correct input or not. Well, now, similarly, others can verify this sortition function by putting up these inputs. Well, so the PK has the proof, seed, threshold, role, and the weights, and it should return J. Well, so if this J matches, that means this J corresponds to this verify sort function. If it matches with the J that have been generated as a part of the sortition function, that means the things get verified. Well, so the person is not telling lie, rather that person has executed this verifiable random function and have been able to correctly elect itself as the leader. Now, after a member is selected, so if a member is selected for proposing a new block, then the committee, then that member participate in this Byzantine Agreement Protocol. Now, the core idea, again, I'm repeating that I have millions of users. I know that running Byzantine Agreement across millions of users, that is not scalable. So what I'm doing that in every round, among those millions of users, I am selecting a small committee, and that small committee is going to verify or going to run a Byzantine Agreement protocol to check whether the block that have been proposed, whether it is a correct block or not. If they agree that this is a correct block, then they collectively sign that block and the block gets added to the blockchain. Well, so that way the cryptographic sortition mechanism is to elect people from that large group who can either propose a block or who can work like a committee for that Byzantine Agreement mechanism. Now let us try to look into this Byzantine Agreement algorithm in Algorand. So Algorand calls it a B star. Why it calls it a B star? Because it runs Byzantine Agreement multiple different times. So what Algorand assumes, so it considers that there are two phases of the agreement protocol. One is called the final consensus and the second one is called the tentative consensus. Now, while defining this final consensus or the tentative consensus, they define this synchronous and the asynchronous mechanism into two steps. One they call as the strong synchrony. So what is strong synchrony? Strong synchrony means that most honest users, say I have 95% of the honest users, they can send message that will be received by most other honest users within a known time bound. Well, so the strong synchrony comes from the assumption that an attacker can control the network momentarily, but the attacker cannot control the network for a long duration. Well, and this strong synchrony assumption is considered to ensure the liveness of the protocol. So again, the FLP impossibility comes here, as we have seen earlier, that in a complete asynchronous system, even with a single crash fault, you will not be able to reach consensus. So that is impossible with a Byzantine failure as well. Now, what they do that, well, for ensuring liveness, it gives priority over strong synchrony. Well, again, here you see that it is a kind of deviation from our proof of work idea. So the proof of work idea, it had given more priority to safety. Sorry, it had given more priority to liveness and less priority to safety. But here, from the experience of proof of work, what we have seen that, well, if I want to give more priority to safety, the type of protocol that we result, it has low transaction throughput. Well, so your commitment latency would be very high. Well, so from that particular aspect, again, this Algorand protocol, they have moved back to the original assumption that had been taken by majority of the standard distributed consensus algorithm. So that is the strong synchronous system. So they assume that to ensure liveness, you need a strong synchronous system. And at the same time, they assume this weak synchrony. So the weak synchrony says that the network can be asynchronous for long, but for bounded period of time. So it is not like that. The network would be asynchronous for all the time. Well, so there must be a strong synchrony period after every weak synchronous period. Well, Now, what they show that Algorand is safe under weak synchrony. So they are again giving priority to safety to prevent that forking. Well, and at the same time to ensure that the transactions are committed much faster compared to what is the commitment latency for our standard proof of work consensus mechanism. Well, so this is again, you can see that a kind of jugglery of terms, right? So the standard distributed consensus mechanism, they had assumed or they have given safety as a priority over liveness, and they resulted a protocol that provide very good transaction throughput, but it only works within a closed environment. But then we have seen proof of work that gives priority to liveness, but the problem of proof of work is that it doesn't work well in terms of the transaction throughput. And then again in Algorand, we are going back to our original Bagentine agreement protocol, giving priority to safety over liveness. And the assumption is that, well, there would be a synchronous period after every asynchronous period when the network would be able to recover from liveness. Well, and the interesting idea that they have posed here is that, well, Bagentine agreement scales well with increasing number of transaction throughput, but the limitation is the number of members that can be there in the consensus group. So for an open network, what you do, you use this verifiable random function to select the members from the open group who becomes the consensus group for every round. So that way, for every round, you run this mechanism to find out a set of newly set of elected committee members, and that committee members will collectively sign the block to verify based on a Bagentine agreement protocol. Now let us see that how this Bagentine agreement protocol does. So this Bagentine agreement, as I mentioned earlier, it considers two different consensus states. One is the final consensus and the second one is the tentative consensus. Now in final consensus, when one user reaches in final consensus, then any other users that reaches final or tentative consensus in the same round must agree on the same block. Okay, so this will ensure the safety. So earlier in the context of PBFT, we have divided my safety requirement into two parts, safety one and safety two, if you remember. So the safety one says that the block will be correct, and the safety two says that it will be the final consensus. That means I have reached it to a consensus finality. That means a unique block has been agreed by all the committee members. So here in this case, what happens, because I am relying on a random committee, now it might always happen that that random committee has more number of adversaries. Now in that case, that committee might agree on a different block compared to the block on which and Bagentine agreement should reach. Well, but what it says that at a final consensus, everyone will reach to the same block value. Okay. So whenever a transaction reaches to the final consensus, you can confirm a transaction. But intermediary, there can be tentative consensus. What is this tentative consensus? The tentative consensus means that the network has been partitioned. That one set of users have agreed on one block, another set of users have agreed on a different block. Well, but both the blocks are correct. Well, so other users may have reached consensus on a different but correct block. Now, this scenario can happen in either of the two cases. So the first case is when the network is strongly synchronous. During that time, it might happen that before the network has reached to the strongly synchronous point, there was the adversaries and the network was under the control of adversaries. So network is under the control of adversaries means I have more than 50% of the adversaries in my consensus group. And remember, that can always happen because I am randomly selecting the consensus group from an open network. So it can always happen that majority of the participants are in consensus group. So they agree on a block, single block, and the correct nodes, they agree on a different block. So that way, I have reached to a tentative consensus. And when the network was weakly consensus, in that case, it can always happen that there are multiple faults and the network has partitioned. So the users are split into groups and different groups have agreed on different blocks. Well, now again, this if you try to match it to the Bitcoin proof of work, so this weakly synchronous mechanism is something similar to Bitcoin proof of work, where different nodes have agreed upon different blocks, although both the blocks are correct. Because if that blocks is invalid, then other users will be able to determine it and they will drop it. So they are agreeing on the valid block, but different blocks. So that is the kind of tentative consensus where we have reached. Now the question comes that from tentative consensus, how can you reach to final consensus? So how can you come out of tentative consensus? So here comes the idea of BS stars. That means rather than running the Bagentine agreement protocol for a single time, you run the Bagentine agreement for multiple times. Well, so and in every time you are running the Bagentine agreement, you use cryptographic sortition. So whenever you are using cryptographic sortition, that means different nodes are selected as leader and they are running that Bagentine agreement protocol. So eventually you will come up with majority of the correct users within your consensus group, and the majority of the correct users will help you to reach into the final consensus. So this is the kind of entire BSTARS algorithm that you use the reduction function, that means use the cryptographic sortition. Then you run the binary BSTARS. Binary BSTARS means you mention whether you are going to accept a block or you are going to reject a block. Then you count the votes. So the count votes means basically you find out that how many are agreeing in each of these votes. And if you see that a tentative consensus has reached, that means some people are agreeing on some set of blocks, another set of people are agreeing on another set of blocks, that means you have reached to a tentative consensus. Otherwise, if you see that the majority of the nodes have agreed on the same block, that means you have been able to reach an Bagentine agreement, then you are in a final consensus. Okay, so the idea is here, the core idea is here, that whenever you are having a tentative consensus, you again apply cryptographic sortition to select a new group and use that group to sign your block. So if I just try to tell you the steps in a simple way, rather than using all these different terminologies, it works in this way, that you have a large number of users. On that large number of users, you apply verifiable random function to select a subset, a set of committee members. Now, because you are applying a verifiable random function and kind of in a random way electing the committee members, it can always happen that the 3A+1 rule is not satisfied. Okay, so it might happen that, well, you have more number of adversaries compared to what you should have. Well, so you should have ideally n/3-1, that many number of adversaries. So n/3-1, that many number of adversaries, if you have n number of nodes in the committee, but you have more number of adversaries. So in that case, you will not be able to reach consensus. Well, because the adversaries have been able to create partition in the network. Well, so in that case, you see that some of the nodes agree on one mechanism and some others agree on another mechanism. So just by running that PBFT quorum, you will not be able to reach to a quorum of 2A+1. So that means you are in a tentative consensus. So whenever you are in a tentative consensus, you again apply cryptographic sortition to select another set of members for your consensus group and again run the Bagentine agreement protocol. So what algorithm says that if your majority of the participants in your network are correct, which should be, otherwise the society cannot run. So that is the quote-unquote statement that have been given by Silvio Micheli in one of his interesting talk on algorithm. He mentioned that, well, in a society, if majority are not good, then the society cannot run. So we always need to assume that majority in a society are good. But whenever you are selecting a subset based on a function, it might happen that you have selected only the bad people. Well, or you have selected the majority of the bad people. So that way, there is a possibility that you can reach to a tentative consensus. But if you run Bagentine agreement multiple times until you have been able to reach to a agreement or a final consensus, then eventually it will guarantee that majority of your elected committee members are good and you will be able to reach to a final consensus. So that is the kind of core idea behind Algorand, which intelligently uses this idea of verifiable random function to select a subset of node from a large open network and then run the Bagentine agreement protocol within that small committee. So this is all about Algorand. Let me know if you have any query or any question. So the Algorand paper has all the theoretical proof behind this argument. So we are not in this course, we are not going to all these theoretical details. I just tried to give you an overall idea about this Algorand protocol. Now, if you are interested, you can go back, look into that paper and try to look into the proof that have been given in the paper. So any doubt or any query? If not, then okay. So let us close today's class. And today we have actually concluded our discussion on consensus. So tomorrow Professor Shural is going to start a new topic. So